6'9". I'm a tall guy. We all know what they say about tall guys. We don't live as long. Yeah, that's like my best pickup line. You looking for a little less commitment? Maybe date a tall guy. It's like getting a hamster instead of a dog. Tell you a little bit about myself. Always been a troublemaker. Always been a troublemaker, but I was always very good at getting out of trouble. I only ever got spanked one time, because the first time that my dad tried to spank me, I looked back and smiled at him. Yeah, that's smart. You walked right in the room. I'm telling you, we can't spank that one again. I think you might like it. Of course, it's not what I was thinking. I was just being a little kid, right? Defiant, like a little William Wallace, you know? Oh, you're gonna spank me? Well, I'll look back and smile at you, because you can take my Legos, but you can't break my spirit, Dad. Should have thought about it. I think I ruined the relationship between me and my father in that one moment, you know? I didn't think about how that was gonna look to him. Turns out, it looked like I turned around on him like a freaky little weirdo, you know? Just, what are you going to do now? Spank me harder, Daddy? So he never spanked me again. He also never hugged me. I'm tall, but I don't think it's a big deal. It's not a big deal because everyone in my family is tall, right? Like, I have an older brother. He is 7 feet tall. Yeah, he's super dumb. It's not really a joke, it's just a mean thing on the same microphone sometimes. We had the same birthday, we shared a room growing up, okay? He's a year older, so he's bigger than me. We would fight a lot, right? We were just too close, we would fight a lot. And he would win the fight because he was bigger, he was older, but I was smarter, so I knew I had to get him back psychologically, right? He was a lifeguard at the local YMCA. One day, I got tired of his crap, I took his lifeguarding whistle, and I coated it in Novocaine. Yeah, like the dentist used to make your mouth numb, right? Next day he goes in and tries to use his whistle, and his mouth goes numb, and all the kids in the pool die. Laughing at this idiot with his loose lips. No running, what's happening to me? It was amazing. Best part about that, I never told him I did it. And he's not the brightest guy. So there's a chance my older brother just thinks that's what happens with whistles sometimes. And I love that because he was a college basketball player, which means there may have been a moment in time where he was sitting on the bench with his teammates yelling at the ref, you know, ref, you're blind, ref, you suck. And then my idiot brother stands up like, yeah, ref, what's wrong? You can't blow the whistle because your mouth got numb from the whistle, because that happens sometimes. With whistles, as we know. I hope that happens. I have a sister as well. I have a little sister. She's 6'4". We picked at her growing up. We created a monster, all right? That girl will walk into a room, scan like a robot, and pick out the things she can make fun of you on, and just crush you, all right? She came to my apartment recently, walked in, immediately noticed I had like 4 beer bottles on my counter. She's like, well, what do you got, a drinking problem over here? I was like, hey, that is a recycling problem. Please respect us. She's always on my case about being successful, too. When are you going to be a successful comedian? When are you going to be a successful comic? Well, first of all, she just obviously hasn't heard about the big show ever tonight, okay? Yeah. I don't mind if people tell you you're not successful either, because success, that's an individual thing. You can decide what success is to you. For some people, it's a six-figure income. Other people, maybe it's getting in shape, having like a six-pack. I've decided what success is for me. If I can make it back to my crappy apartment with a six-pack of beer and a big-ass chimichanga, I win. That's beautiful. I set the bar so low, I ain't never made a champion. I need a six-figure income. I'm gonna have to get a six-pack. By the way, neither do you. We live in the Pacific Northwest. Lie about that. Yeah, I got a six-pack. You want to see it? Not today. It's raining. Back in the dry season. My sister, she's got a lot of hobbies. She likes documentaries. She loves documentaries. But what she'll do now, she'll drink like a bottle of wine, watch a documentary, get herself all angry, and she'll call me at like 1 in the morning to yell at me about this documentary I've never seen. She told me the other day, she watched from a sweatshop. You know, I always try to like make jokes, and she hates it, right? So she calls me for tracks. Do you have any idea where the worst part about working in a sweatshop is? And I was like, is it the Monday? Oh man, you can't joke about that. You know what it's like. You know what it's like to be a sweatshop worker. And I was like, well, I may not know what it's like to be a sweatshop worker, but I have walked a lot of miles in their shoes. And then I hung up the phone. Because that's what we call a closer. I moved recently. I like where I live. I live right just outside of Seattle. I've got a neighbor now. I've never really had a neighbor in my adult life. And I like it. He's got a routine. Every day before he goes to work, he'll hang out in front of my place. And he likes to smoke a joint with one hand while he chugs a giant Monster energy drink with his other hand. You know? Just alternating betwixt the two. Like a real overachiever. First time I saw that, I was like, man, someone needs to tell him about cocaine. We'd get high in energy, but there's a more efficient way. Okay, let's do some science later. I did move. I live just out of Seattle now. I moved outside. I moved closer to the airport. I'm flying a lot. And I love living there. Now what I'll do is start taking the bus. I'll take the bus into the city. I'll do a show, get very drunk, and I'll take the bus home. And that drunken bus ride home is about my favorite thing in the goddamn world. I'm the only one on the bus that I'm sitting there looking out the window, you know, having crazy drunken bus thoughts. Maybe I'm going to steal this bus right now. Who's going to stop me? The bus driver? He hates his job. He's going to help me. Anyway, I was on this bus, and I don't know where the bus pulls over. This bus never pulls over. A woman got on the bus. No one gets on this bus. Here's the deal with this lady. She was super high on what? Life. And a lot of meth. Real life in that situation going on. And I love it. She got on the bus and did not even pretend like she was going to pay. She just walked out like, woo! And I was like, wow. She just walked past him. And that's kind of when I was like, I could have sold this bus. And I was nervous when she got on. It's very inebriated people. You did not know this. They were being tall as very inebriated people. They're drawn to you, okay? I don't know why. It's something deep and psychological from their childhood. They just look up to you and they're like, okay, right? Sometimes it's okay. Sometimes it's kind of cute. It's like, are you? Look at you. Other times it's more dangerous, right? Like, you're not my dad. So I wasn't sure what she was gonna do. She got on the bus, she saw me, got excited as they do, and she walked up to me, squared up, and then she said the craziest thing anyone's ever said to me. She said, crazy town, lady town, crazy train. Choo-choo. All aboard. I'm not sure how you guys would respond to that. I wasn't really sure how I was going to respond to that. I think that's one of those moments that teaches you what kind of person you are, and I'm the kind of person that will respond to that with cool beans, peaches and cream. Not bad. No nonsense for nonsense, right? That's a stalemate. Now she has to leave me alone. That's just bus rules. I think she understood that and she started turning away. But as she turned away, it's like she realized, oh wait, hold on, because I'm crazy. In fact, as she planted her foot, this is what she said. She turned, planted her foot, and said, home girl, slap it, say boo. You can't do this to me. I mean, served that I was. I was having a great time moments ago. I said the only thing I had. I came back at her. I didn't have anything. I had to make something up. I said, uh-oh, boom, boom. And she gave me a high five and got on the bus at the next stop. Now, here's what we can learn from this, okay?
Because I thought about it endlessly. I dissected it in my mind. Here's what we can learn. Methamphetamine, hey, that's a language. It's all catchphrases, okay? I'll subtitle all that for you. She walks out and says, crazy town, lady town, crazy train. Subtitle. Well, I'm super high on meth right now. Would you like to be friends? Cool beans, peaches, and cream. Subtitle. Well, I don't feel safe near you. Can you see friendly? She said, hold her a slap and say, ooh, subtitle. Well, I'm sorry. I just thought you looked like a cool guy. I said, uh-oh, boom, boom, subtitle, hell yeah, I'm a cool guy, high five and get the hell off my bus, lady. Seriously. Single, I haven't always been. Last girl I dated had narcolepsy. You know what that is? Yeah. Falls asleep randomly, right? That's the disease. And I didn't know she had it when we started dating. We were just drinking buddies, which, by the way, narcoleptics make the best drinking buddies. Up till early in the morning, going back shop, passing out, waking up, doing another one. I was like, hell yeah, check this out, guys. From the badass over here. Just that narcolepsy tripping. She never told me she had it. She never told me. I found out because she was giving me a ride home. On the freeway. She's the weirdo. She just kind of narcs out real quick. You know, took a little narky nap, just slumped over, starts drinking across the lane. I'm freaking out. I know she had narcolepsy. I'm grabbing the steering wheel. Like, baby, naps are awesome. Prioritize for now. I used to not like talking about it on stage because I was going to be drunk. That coming to me afterwards, like, oh, I got an idea for a joke. You're dating with narcolepsy. Did she ever fall asleep during sex? Talk about that.
No.
Well, let's talk about that, because it's going to make everyone feel a little awkward, kind of uncomfortable. Maybe it's going to get a little bit quiet, and I'm going to start feeling uncomfortable. I want to feel that awkwardness. And once we're all down there, there's only one way to get out of it. Happened one time. It did. Happened one time. Humiliating for both of us. Destroyed my sexual ego. But I did my research, and it turns out narcolepsy actually triggered by dopamine, which is released when the body feels pleasure. So it's less than she fell asleep during sex, and more like pleasure her unconscious. That's the best way to phrase it. She had moderate to severe narcolepsy. The thing about that is, so I can say it was triggered by dopamine. There's a lot of things that trigger dopamine. One of those things, laughter. Okay? And she would always stop taking her meds. She didn't like the fact she had it. She was always in denial. And you kind of tell, she'd get weird and twitchy sometimes and say, baby, did you stop taking your meds? And she'd say, yeah, but I think I'm pretty much over it. I don't think I have anymore. I think I pretty much got over it. And say, okay, well, it's not the common cold. Can't take those meds. Nah, I'm over it. And it's triggered by laughter, right? So what I would say is, well, that's cool. Hey, guess what? Tickle, tickle. And then she'd say, ha ha, oh no. And she'd start laughing out. On her way down, she would grab a blanket and pull it over her face. So when she woke up, I wasn't the first thing that she saw. She was great. Probably the smallest woman I've ever dated. She was like 5'3", 100 pounds. One time I saw her eat a 1 pound burrito, I was like, damn girl, you're like 1% burrito by weight right now. She had her nipples pierced, which, I don't know, that's not a big deal, but she would bring it up at parties a lot. Like, we'd be at a party, and I'd be standing behind her, she'd be talking to somebody, like, yeah, I got her pierced, and I don't know, I just think it might make it harder to put your breastfeed next behind her, like, whoa, I know, is that what we're talking about? Okay. I think it's going to make it easier, like a sprinkler head, no? Come on, give me a lot on a hot summer day. One time we were in the apartment and she bent over to tie her shoes, and I thought it would be cute to kind of sneak up behind her and give her a little pat on the butt, you know? That's a cute thing couples do. I've seen it in movies. So I walked up behind her, I gave her a little spank, and she looked back and smiled at me. So I never hugged her again. That's how I was raised. Before I forget, I do I do sell something before the show, after the show. I see you have not brought it on the stage with me. It's a t-shirt that says, oh, did I? I like to play hide and seek with myself. That's a really good question. I'm not high right now. You should see where I am. I sell the shirt that says Crazy Town, Lady Town, Crazy Train. Does that seem like one? You can talk to me after the show. I wonder if those scavenger moments just had my heart's racing. Speaking of heart racing, anyone here ever been skydiving before? Woo! That's awesome. I always wanted to skydive when I was a kid. That was a big deal for me. Because I always wanted to touch a cloud. I know that seems silly, but how epic to touch a cloud. I was also a little fat boy, and I thought they looked like cotton candy. I knew they worked, but I wanted to try. Right? If my teachers would be worried about me, they'd pull me aside from class, and they'd say, Travis, you know clouds are just condensed water at high altitude. And I'd say, yeah, probably most of them, but there's no way you check them all. It's got to be that cotton candy one or two, and I'm going to find it. I hit 21, I was old enough. I got there. The first thing they had you do is put on a jumpsuit. They didn't have one my size. So I squeezed into one three sizes too small. The damn thing fit me like a wrestling singlet. Too short in the legs and the arms, and way too short in the torso, which is a bummer because then it'll cinch up real quick. Look, outline the net a bit. Let me set the stage for you. Childhood dream? Flashing a landing field. I was embarrassed, but I figured, hey, big life experience ahead, I gotta see this through. So then I got to meet my jumping instructor, who had to be strapped to my shoulders, as I had never jumped before. But I think they picked the wrong guy for me, because he's about 5'8". Because he put this man on like a backpack, just one strap his head. Asking me to stop, no, I won't. He looked like, you ever seen parents walking around with that toddler knapsack? I said, he's a lot older than me, so I'm just walking around looking like the brown father of a much older man. Just piggybacking on a vision button, you know? Embarrassing, but I said, hey, big life experience, you gotta see this through. So then I got to meet my jumping crew, a bunch of 20, 30-year-old adventure seeker types. And there was one 80-year-old woman that day. It was really cool. She just ran a marathon. She was kicking stuff off her bucket list, you know? And she had, I remember exactly how she looked. She was very energetic. She had poofy gray hair and braces, because apparently it's her age into that. I'm not saying there should be. What I'm saying is if you make it to 80, your teeth are still there, leave them alone. It works so hard for you. I liked her, I wanted to be her friend, but I couldn't be her friend because she creeped on me so hard. Yeah, she saw me and she was like, that is on the bucket list. This is my beautiful one. She was so subtle too. She walked up, so subtle. She walked up and said, how tall are you? I said, 6'9". And then she said, oh, wish you could give me a few inches. Teacher. So it's like a bench you sit on, there's a door you jump out of the staging area, so you kind of have to stage before you jump out of the plane. Everyone is sitting on the bench in the order of how they're going to jump. I jump last, I'm on the end by the door. Everyone else is getting to sit normal, by the way, but I got a guy strapped to my back. So I'm going to sit kind of spread eagle, you know, with his legs wrapped around me. In a lover's embrace. And we discussed in among your secrets, right? Those are high and tight, and we're by the door, so that's really the last sight anyone gets to see before they die into the abyss. Just a man wrapped around a larger man. I can't make jokes about it. Nice fall, see you next fall. And I got down, the last person to jump before him was that 80-year-old woman, you guys. And she got up, she was so excited, she had gusto. Moxie, her generation would call it. And she blew right past that staging area and decided instead to stage her kooky old self directly on top of my lap. And she just kind of sat down, looked back, gave a very bracing smile, a slow little rip rip, and just jumped out of my hand. I random strangers. But if you do, totally jump on a plane afterwards. There was a slick exit, one knee back over.
Oh, you brassy bro.
Okay, she's down on Earth. And you on Facebook, maybe. I'm sitting there thinking maybe I'm on the jump after all. Maybe that was my big life experience. And I realized this guy strapped to my back didn't see any of that. He just felt a bit of a jibble. So I stand up. He starts doing his routine. Cowabunga, you would have been button that lip hole, man. Actually, I'm looking out with all these clouds. I'm talking to him. It's you, cloud. It's been you since childhood. He's having second thoughts, but he can't stop me, right? He's yelling at me, don't jump into a cloud. Shut up about my dreams. Picked out a cloud and I counted down. I said, 3, 2, 1. I jumped. And you guys, clouds are condensed water. And condensed water at high altitude, well, that'll be ice. Yeah, and isothermal velocity is not fluffy at all, okay? It's very sharp. It can actually break your skin, which is why they have you wear that jumpsuit. Oh wait, mine didn't fit. So my arms just rocking towards the earth. My arms and legs are being shredded. And the only thing I can picture in my mind is my 80-year-old lap dance at 10,000 feet. Thank you guys very much for being a friend of mine. Thank you for the rest of the show.
You get a shirt after the show. I'll give you 2 free tickets to next month's show. If you purchase his shirt after the show, 2 free tickets to next month's show. Cheers, everybody. I'll take another shot. Raise your glasses. Take another shot. Take care. This is for your servers and your waste staff and your employees. They're amazing. They do this every month for us. Most Sunday nights are just kind of tame. This is the craziest Sunday night, so take care of them and cheers to them. Excited to introduce your headliner, one more stand-up comedian. He's been on Comedy Central, and he's been on NBC. Please welcome to the stage, my good buddy, with a big warm round of applause, Dwayne Goad, everyone!
Thank you, Gordon McGillis, everyone here. Gordon McGillis, doing a great job. We've got Gordon McGillis, Chris, Casey, Maddie, Travis. It's like the Musketeers, we're all here tonight. How are we doing, Everett? Come on, this is a big night. Big night, Everett. Yes, sir. It's a pleasure to be here. A lot of couples here. Happy night out. I am married, so this is great for me. My wife's at home. We didn't have the date night. That's a big thing when you're married, the date night. Well, how many married folks we got here? Where's the married? Right up. Yeah, there we go. This is your date night, isn't it? Date night. Women love it. Date night. Women call it date night. Guys don't. Guys will say, we're going out. That's what we normally say. Hey, what are you doing this weekend? We're going out. Yeah, so like, what are you doing? Date night. So, it's pretty fun. We're going to hit her and go to dinner. It's our date night. Women love to call it date night. I found out why, as we married, so I've been married 15 years, I found out why they call it date night. I think for women, it's a night of fantasy, I think. I think it's a date. I'm thinking, hey, I'm not stuck with this guy. It's just a date. I still have options. That's what I'm thinking. And then that bill comes. And you go, oh, that's for our joint checking account. Okay, this is not what I thought it was. This is different. Okay, forget it. I guess he's going to spend the night. Ugh. That's it. Maybe it's just for our house, but. Every couple is different for their date night. That's why you find out. For us, when I have a date night with my wife, it's a big deal. She's so excited. She's like, and it's not just a date. It's I have to get dressed up. I have to leave the house for an hour while she gets ready. Then I have to come back to my own home, knock on the door to pick her up like we're out on a date. That's my house. I got keys to get in. Myself, and knock on the door because it's date night. And the weird part is, I have to wear a leather mask. I don't like that part of it. That's uncomfortable. Maybe I'm too concerned, but I feel very uncomfortable. Who is it? Who is it, stranger? It's me. Open the goddamn door. You guys got the zipper joke. That's pretty good. That doesn't always work. Like in Utah. I'll explain that one. Glad you guys all came out. It's kind of fun. I've been married 15 years. Got a little boy. A little boy is just turned 12, which he might make 13. We'll see. I don't like children, to be honest with you. I didn't want to have kids. Like, I can't stand kids. I mean, I like my kid. He's a good shit. I know him. He's all right. But other people, that's how you know you're a good father. They say, he's a good shit. That's my son. He's a pretty good egg, this one. But I didn't want to have kids. I was scared. I don't like punk kids. You go to the mall. I was up in the Everett mall today, which has become MySpace. There's nothing happening. Holy shit. It's so sad. Jesus Christ, just level that thing. Look at shit mall. Just a bunch of tequila posters floating through the parking lot. But you know these malls, I see these little punk kids walking around their ads, like, yeah, what you want, punk? What you want, bitch? I want a Coke, you work here. This is the worst subway I've ever been to. His attitude is terrible. He is an Andrew, I can't talk to anybody. Walking through the streets, like gang shooters? I don't know what it was. People see his fingers, I walk by his. I was trying to be cool back. Hey, what up, G? I hurt my fingers. I threw this arthritic claw move back. I have no idea what I'm doing. I'm telling deaf kids to fuck off, for all I know. Keep my arm, you asshole. I got an asshole. Yeah, keep calling me in the moment, put it in your ass. Oh, shit. This is deep. That deaf kid's pretty pissed off. We should just walk out. I don't have any problems. I don't like this kids. They're awful. My son, at 12, I'll tell him to do something, and he'll say no and run away. He'll just run out of the room. And you know, if you have kids nowadays, you can't hit them because of the goddamn neighbors. They're out of your business. It's going to end up on the news. So you have to find ways to get your aggression without hurting anybody in your family. So now when my son runs off, I flip him off, and that feels pretty good. Have you done that yet, kids? Let me try flipping. In a yoga class, all the tension leaves my body, goes at my fingertips, I find my center. I think I lost weight doing this. By the way, I don't do it to his face, I'm not a jerk. I do it behind his back, like I do to everybody else when I give him the finger. The same way I do it to cops and Starbucks employees. I'm joking, of course, I like cops. But, it feels great. I did tell my wife I was doing this though, so she's trying to go for a shower a couple nights ago. And I go, go for your shower. She's like, no, and he runs to his room like, and just as I was doing it, she comes out, she catches me, flipping him off. She's like, what the hell are you doing? Now, I'm not afraid of my wife. I get a little nervous when she caught me. I didn't know how to explain myself. Like, babe, I'm not a scientist. I've been through experiments, and I find if I flip the boy off, nobody gets hurt, I feel better, and really a win-win for the family. She just goes, God, you're an idiot, and she walked out of the room. Like, I want to spare anybody in your family if I'm trying to get out. It's not just for children. I'm onto something with this. I cannot wait for the holidays when her family comes over. Give the ultimate test. I did get sure doing it though. The next night, same thing. Go for your shower. No, she's like, yeah. Hey! She goes, it is really good. And we high five and share that kid. So it's a good night. Brought us together as a couple. I like being a dad. It's fun. I got one kid. That's all I got. That's enough. That's good. You have no friends. There's no one to play with. But like, you're all right. Play some games. Trying to get that Nintendo Switch. Holy shit. Are we trying to find that for their kids? It's like looking for crack in Utah. Not happening. Let's play these video games all the time. I'm not very good at video games. My wife bought me a video game system years ago. When we first started dating, she got me good gifts. Now that we're married, we get shit gifts. I don't know what happened over the years. But the first year we were dating, she got me a PlayStation. I was like, okay, I don't play video games, but all right. So she got me this one game. It's called Grand Theft Auto, which is a lot of different versions. I got the version that's called Vice City. It's set in the 80s, and I loved it. So we're going to be on play. And I don't know what I'm supposed to do with this game. I just drive around, listen to 80s hits, and kill hookers. That's all I do. I love Duran Duran. I love killing hookers. That's all I know. I play this thing all the time, but I can't play it because she'll walk in, she'll stand and watch me play it. she, I'm playing it wrong. She's like, you're not even playing this right. I go, well, that's pretty fun. She's like, you're supposed to do a mission. Every time you do a mission, you get money for the mission. I go, God, it's sad that even this game, I don't make enough money for you. Like, I'm doing my best. Like, I don't need to be upset. There are cops looking for me. That's even my car. I stole it. There are piles of dead hookers all over town. I didn't have insurance. If they find me, I'm going away for a long time. This game is not resetting the right way. My son, he wants to play all the video games and he wants me to play with him. I'm like, I'll watch you. I'm like that old man, like, let me just watch you play these fun games with your rock and roll. Because I'm getting older now. I don't like getting old. It feels shitty, you know? Turn 46. Someone's going to say, that's not old. No, that's because you're way old. 46 is old enough. Remember when you turn 40, you're going to say, 40 is 20. After trying to fuck a 20-year-old, you're a creepy old dude. But you guys want to dance? You guys want to dance? Want to dance? Okay, later. See you later. Hi. Like your purse, sit down, I'll buy you a drink. Sit down, I'll buy you a drink. Okay, have fun with your friends dancing. See you later. I'll be in the back in the corner in the shadows watching you dancing all night. Why do I have to leave? That'd be beautiful. That's what I'm here for, you creepy old dude. Losing my hair, which I'm not happy about, you know? I used to have good hair, now it's all falling apart. I actually want to get new hair. I want to do those commercials. You see those commercials where the guys are getting that Bosley, whatever the hell it is, you know? And they're so defensive about getting their... I can cut this hair if I want to cut this hair. I'm like, hey, all right. Take it easy. I'll wash this hair. I'll swim in this goddamn hair if I want to swim in it. Okay. Do it. Don't tell me you can't. So upset about having hair. I like to get new hair, but the problem is I'm all my friends are comedians. They're going to make fun of me as soon as I get my new transplants. I know. Which bothers me, because Elton John, that fucker, he started his career bald-headed. He's got bangs. Nobody questions it at all. What kind of Elton John? They got that new album coming out, Elton's good stuff. Let me ask you about that hair of yours. With the spit curl. That's... I'm going to ask him about it. I got this shampoo. I went to Ulta. My wife says, you should go to Ulta and get some new shampoo. So I went to Ulta, and they had stuff called Nioxin. And it's a shampoo that's supposed to help me get my hair back. So I started getting this Nioxin stuff. I thought it was working. I'm sure it wasn't. I think my wife was just drawing hair in while I was sleeping. And I don't know what's wrong. By the way, you go, this, I'm getting new hair. Great. But the problem is, it's a medicated shampoo, so there's side effects. So eventually I started getting these bad stomach aches. I couldn't use anymore. I was walking around, oh shit, my stomach's killing me. I think that's Nioxin's brilliance in their marketing, going, hey, it's going to cause stomach aches, that's only going to help us. Is that people walk like, oh, Christ, my stomach's killing me for that shampoo. Hey, wait, okay, hey, your hair looks great. Yeah, it's really coming in. It's really good. How's this movie? Is that Tom Cruise talking? Is that Tom Cruise? No, he's not there? Okay.